just want to take a moment and read a couple of scriptures here. In Hebrews, if you want to follow with me, in the 5th chapter. Please folks get down. Nobody's fell out of their chair this morning, so we're doing good. Better than last week, huh? Anyway. It's one of those things you had to be there. In the 5th chapter of Hebrews, starting in the 7th verse, who in the days of his flesh, when he was offered up prayers and supplications with strong crying and tears unto him that was able to save him from death and was heard in that he feared. Though he were a son, yet learned he obedience by the things which he suffered. And being made perfect, he became the author of eternal salvation unto all them that obey him. When we have a faith for Jesus Christ, it has to be an obedient faith. He was obedient to God. He cried to God that this cup might pass from him. But he was obedient and did what God wanted him to do, even though it wasn't what he wanted. This time, Brother Jim can commence.
Thank you, Brother Tom. I want to turn in your hymn books number 632, and I want you to think about that theme. Time enough yet. All of us have a tendency, we're procrastinators. Even if we're a Christian here today, there was a time in our life when God revealed, you need to change your life. You need to get it together. And yet we pushed that away from us, and it cost us dearly. And it's costing people today. The Bible says, be not deceived. God is not mocked. Whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. He said, if you sow to the Spirit, you will of the Spirit reap spiritual things. You sow to the flesh, you will of the flesh reap fleshly things. Christianity is not complicated. It's not mysterious. Sometimes we maybe have a tendency to make it that way. And I defend your right this morning. If you want to go to hell, I defend your right. You got a right to do that. If you want to go to heaven, I defend that right to be free. One of the things I think of the way the devil operates, or he has with me, is he gets me all bogged down because things aren't going the way I think they ought to go, or people are not being saved, or something else. And it always comes back to me. He said, Jimmy, do your job. You just preach the word and let people handle it however they want to. And you can run, but you can't hide. There's two things that's sure in this life. One of them is fleshly, and that's taxes. The other one is physical death. Those two things you are not going to avoid. And so why not do something about it? In this message this morning, I want you to pick out your weakest point in your Christian relationship with God. What is the biggest weakness that I have that maybe keeps me from being more happy or more outgoing? What's bogging me down? What's worrying me? What's pulling me down? And those are the things that we need to operate on. I want you, for just a moment, I want to go to Isaiah chapter 51. And there's four verses in there that I think fits a lot of our situations in life. I've got the New King James Version. It's going to be just a slight difference in wording, but it's got the same meaning. He said, listen to me, you who follow after righteousness. None of us are going to reach the point of perfection or where we get to where we don't need the Lord and we don't need each other and we don't need anything. And he said, if we're seeking after righteousness, listen up. And here's what can help us. You who seek the Lord, look to the rock from which you were hewn. I came into this house when I was 22 years old, a very disturbed young man, a mixed up young man, not so good a person, had a bad attitude, had all of those things, tried everything in life for happiness until I found it in this house. And that's been 54 years ago. God is able to keep what is His. And there's a lot of people that go through life afraid of falling away, afraid of making a mistake, afraid of doing this. And all of the time, God is your support. You were hewn from the rock. You were established. And what God has established, it's going to be difficult to destroy that. And then on the other side, he said, and to the hole of the pit from which you were dug. Never forget what you were. And somebody will say, we need to forget the past. We need to forget it. And we can't. We go back to it. It's in our human nature to reflect and to go back. That is the way the devil operates. He said, look what you were. Look what you did. Look what you said. Look the way you were living. We don't need to do that. That's gone. That's forgiven. The only thing that we do with our past is we learn from it that we don't make the same mistake again. The devil has no intentions of you having any happiness in any shape, form, or fashion. That is not his way of design. What is happiness? If you look at the human nature side, man is a dreamer. Man is a builder. Man is all of these things. And we design something and we say, that is so beautiful. And 5 years later, we want to remodel it. Why? Because the eye is never satisfied. It cannot be satisfied because it is a part of our flesh. It's a part of our body. And the body can't be satisfied. We get hungry. We eat. And about 4 hours later, we want to do it again. But our spirit is an entirely different area. The only thing that will satisfy our spirit is in our relationship with God. You would think sometimes God is a doormat. You know, just be there when I need you. I'm going to do what I want to. Just be there when I need you. Be there when I get sick. Take care of my body. Be there when I take my last breath. And no matter what he's asked us to do in the present time, we expect God to do that. You better read your Bible. God doesn't act like that. God says there's a time when I won't hear you. I won't listen to you. And we need to get it right now. What have I offered? What have I got to offer God if I wait till I'm 100 years old? What have I got to offer God? It cheapens me in the sight of God. We need to remember God in our youth. Remember him in your youth when you have strength to build and to do these things. I have never forgotten. I pull on my past. I am a sinner saved by grace, and I will be until the day that God redeems me. Having said that, I want you to go to the book of Matthew, and in the 11th chapter, I want to speak for just a few minutes this morning. We can all make excuses, and we're all masters at it at some time in our life. And I think sometimes we think God is somebody that can be fooled. And he can't. And so Jesus, in what I'm going to read in the 28th, starting with the 28th verse, and we're going to talk a minute about the cure for our problems. He said, come unto me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Now, what would you give today to have peace of mind and rest? Do you remember that thing I said at the first of the service? Go back and pick your weakest point. Go back and pick what is troubling you today. And Jesus said, I can take care of that. I can give you rest from that. Are we contented inside or are we discontented? What causes us to be discontented? We looked at the world today. We talked about the world. and it's just like a black fog over every institution. Let me tell you something. That started in Genesis. Cain killed his brother. He slew his brother Abel. And we've been doing it ever since, and we're going to continue to do it. We're not going to change human nature. Humans cannot change humans. God can change human nature. God can take a person like myself, like I was, and totally just remake me. And I've thought about it and studied about it in our statistics in our world today, and we're a Christian nation. Yes, we are. We were founded on it. Whether that's politically correct or not, and I'm not politically correct in anything. Let me tell you where we're at in society today when you have humankind that has went under the animal kingdom and are doing things that the animal kingdom will not do. That is how low humanity has sunk in this country. And it's becoming part of our civil law. And you say, it doesn't affect me. Don't kid yourself. You can't live in this society and not be affected by it in some way. And so what do we do about it? We listen to the voice of God. Jesus said, do this one thing. Do this one thing. He said, don't fear man who can destroy the body. But he said, I tell you rather fear God, who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Let that sink in. Because there's people with today of the Christian faith that's making that decision. And I'm talking about Jimmy. I whine and I cry about this, and I whine and cry about this, and I think, my God, what are people going through? And here I sit, and I've got enough to eat, and I've got friends, and I've got loved ones, and I've got all of these things that you have blessed me with. What am I crying about? What's wrong with us? Have we deviated and changed from the preaching of the old-fashioned way of preaching when it said, you've got to be born again? You can go out here and in your morals, and I encourage them, you can do all of the good in the world and still lose your soul in hell in the day of judgment of God. God said you must be born again, not of flesh, not of corruptible seed, by the incorruptible seed, by the word of God. He told Nicodemus. Nicodemus came to him. Nicodemus was a wise man, a ruler in the Sanhedrin. And there was something about the master when he preached. And that spirit touched Nicodemus's life. And he said, good master, what do I need to do? He said, you must be born again. He said, that's an impossibility. And Jesus said, no, not your natural birth. That is an impossibility. Once you're born, you're born. But you see, humanity has to be remade, remolded. And that's the only way we'll ever change. And that happened to me 50-something years ago, and it's as good today as it was the day I got up out of my seat and I manned up. We need to man up. If life is troubling you and you're in trouble and you can't live with yourself, you can't live with nobody else until any individual. A man can't live with his wife until he can live with himself. A woman can't live with a man until she can live with herself. You can't live with your kids until you can live with yourself. There's the root problem. We've got everything in this country that any generation ever needed. We've got fine homes and we've got this, and we look at it, never mind that all hell is breaking loose inside because people are not in harmony with God. In harmony with God. Born again. I'm not talking about an epiphany. I'm not talking about an experience. I'm talking about spiritually being reborn again. Where God remakes our mind and we think different. We act different. We are different. And only God can do that. In Matthew, they had a lot of trouble then when Jesus walked the earth. Rome ruled the world. They had bad laws. They were enforcing them on people. The world was in turmoil. The world will be in turmoil until Christ comes back. Yes, it will escalate. Yes, it will get worse because we're told that. But listen to what he told the masses, beginning in verse 28 of Matthew 11. Come unto me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. If you're not at rest this morning, he said, come on. Let's do it. Let's get this thing done. Till you can be at rest. What does it matter if you live to be 90-year-old and you live in misery? What good has it done? And I was sitting up here a minute ago thinking about Brother R. Nickel. I said, how many funerals does that man preach? How many songs have him and Bonnie sang? Their life meant something. I don't know anything else about it. And somebody's going to remember something about you. Maybe that was the awfulest grouch I ever seen. Or maybe that was the kind-heartedest person I ever seen. You make that kind of decision. Nobody else makes that for you. And those are the things on this good day that I remember about him. I can't tell you what he had. I have no idea about anything except he was a preacher. And they helped a lot of people in their bad times. How is somebody going to remember you? Did you ever stop to think about that? What are they going to say about you? That's important. Because it will govern and direct our lives. What we care about the future, we will do today. We will take care of that today. Now here's the way he said you do it. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me. Not from your mom or your dad. You're taught as a child and we're commanded to do that. But he said you've got to learn something from me. Let you and I talk about it. Let's discuss it. Let's analyze it. That's what he's saying. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me. And here he said, here's what I am. I am gentle and lowly in heart. And the results of yoking up. And you will find rest. Not to your body. Your body will rest with approximately 6 to 8 hours sleep. You're regenerated if you sleep well. But your soul never rests. It never rests. It keeps coming back. It keeps coming back. It keeps coming back. And there is no rest. And Jesus said, we need to have our souls rested. And here's the reason. He said, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. God does not do bad things. That might surprise you. But God permits bad things to happen. Look in the Bible. Look in the Bible and see those examples. God permitted things to happen because people were doing things they shouldn't have been doing. And it wasn't God's fault. No more than it is today. I don't blame him for what's happening. I blame evil. And he permits it to bring about the cycle of his prophecy, to bring it all home and bring it together. I'm just a part of that, just as you are. Now, used to, a long time ago, everybody saw a yoke. You got two holes, usually in a cross piece. And you hook these animals to them. And when they pull together, the load moves. But let's say, for instance, you just want to be rebellious or cantankerous. And so I'm over here pulling this one, and you're pulling this one. That is the illustration that Jesus was given when you are yoked with him. When you are yoked with him, we pull evenly. We see things the same way. Our minds runs in the same channel. And we pull together and we get the job done. Or if you want to, it's your business. I'd like to see everybody saved, but somebody going to fill hell up. Somebody going to fill it up. And somebody, God, is coming back to redeem and to take home to be immortal. Make a choice. Your decision. I have done my job and I have done it well. I have not shunned to declare unto you the whole counsel of God. You do with your life whatever you want to do. But you cannot do it without a reaction. For every action, there is a reaction. Maybe if we find ourselves in bad places today, do you think God put us there? No, we put ourselves. We put ourselves. How much time you got? Anybody know? Time is not a factor in a relationship with God. He said, I'll come at the time you least expect me. Time. Our little song that we're going to sing, it says, there's time enough yet. And I used to say this, hey, I got some things I got to do before I get it right and all this. And I'm glad he gave me that time. We may not all be that fortunate. Now, if you're contented with the life you're living today, this sermon's probably not going to even help you. You probably turned me off somewhere. But if you got problems, you should have worked on it by now. Remember going in, I said, you pick what is the greatest obstacle in your life and work on it. And I hope you've done that. And I hope you work through it. And I pray that God would speak to you. As we all stand together and sing. I want to thank you for your offering. You're sure to be used in the building of the church. I don't want to take up too much of Brother Tom's time. But here, turn to John chapter 15. Starting in verse 1, he says, I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. And every branch that beareth fruit, he purges it, or he prunes it, that it may bring forth more fruit. Now ye are clean through the word which I have spoken to you. Abide in me, and I in you. As a branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine, no more can ye, except ye abide in me. We can't bear fruit unless we're in Christ. Verse 5, it says, I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit, for without me, he can do nothing. If a man abide not in me, he is cast forth as a branch, and is withered, and men gather them and cast them into the fire, and they are burned. If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, you shall ask what you will, and it shall be done unto you. You know, we are the branches, you and I, that Christ is talking about here. And if we are in this vine and he prunes us, then we can bear fruit. Fruit for him. When we accept Christ in our hearts, the Holy Spirit comes into our lives and into our hearts so that we can bear fruit for Christ. As he said, we can't do anything without him. We have to have Christ in our hearts to bear fruit. Brother Tom brings a message.
morning. I want to welcome everyone here to Lacey Creek this morning. I explained to my Sunday school class today that the Lord had pumped me up. I haven't had coffee. I haven't had a big glass of tea or anything. But we've talked about the Holy Spirit in our Sunday school class, and we'll be studying it for a while, and invite you to come if you're not and attend that. If you're here today, you're meant to be here. It's not a coincidence that the message that I'm going to bring today and the song we're going to sing at the close is 114, I Want to Be a Worker. And then Paul gets up here and talks about that we need to bear fruit. And that's what I'm going to talk about today. And those are not coincidences. God is here today. He says that where two or three are in his name are gathered, he's in the midst. He's here today. He's sending a message to each and every one of you here today. So sit back and listen, be attentive to it. And if God speaks to your heart today, you need to act upon that. If you are here today and you're a Christian, we're going to talk about bearing fruits, as Paul said. If you're here today and you're not a Christian and God is speaking to you and telling you that you need to step out and move toward him, that's what you need to do. Today is the day of salvation, Paul said. I want you to turn with me to the second chapter of James. I always invite you to do that because I may misspeak a word, get in a big way sometimes trying to tell three thoughts at the same time. And again, as I said, if I name this verse, and we're going to go to our bulletin. If you'll look in our bulletin, it's loaded this week with things about how can we work for God or what are we doing for God. I want to read you this verse out of Philippians before we start. We are going to the second chapter of James. But this sets it up to me. And God, you know, I explain this over and over again, and it just made me so happy when Paul read those. God gives me these messages, and to know that they coincide with what he gave to Paul just makes me put a little more fire in my cannon to do what I do because I think I'm doing what God wants me to do. Philippians 2, 13 and 14, listen to me here. For it is God which worketh in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure. Verse 14, do all things without murmuring and disputing. You go, wow, that's pretty abstract. What's that mean? God's Spirit, if we will abide with it, is helping us to want to obey. Sometimes this carnal mind that we have doesn't want to obey. So if we are in the Spirit with God, his Spirit will not only help us to obey, but it will help us to want to obey. And it also is going to help us to do the things and make known to us the things that we should do through that Holy Spirit. Now, if we look at James in the second chapter, beginning with the 14th verse, and this is a message that I'm sure has been spoken many times. It says, what doth it profit, my brethren, though a man say he hath faith and hath not works, can faith save him? If a brother or a sister be naked or destitute of daily food, and one of you say unto them, depart in peace and be ye warmed and filled, notwithstanding you give them not those things that are needful to the body, what does it profit? We have to recognize that people have needs and that we need to act upon those needs sometimes. To simply say, well, I see you're hungry and I see you need some clothes, I'm going to go home and pray for you. Are there any works there? Is that the response that you would want? Are you going to go home and pray that somebody else will fill that need that they have? You know, I'm preparing this sermon, and yesterday somebody called me and said, I need you. And I thought, you know, I've got a day planned. I've got three or four things I need to do. And I'm sitting here thinking, somebody has called me with a need. Am I going to say, well, I hope you find somebody to do that for you? I got up and went and did what it was I wanted. Because that's maybe what God wanted me to do. Those things that I neglected yesterday, the world won't come to an end. But it got done what that person called and requested me to do. You've got to go back to that Philippians that I started this off with, is that God will help us to want to do the things that we should do And God will help us to do those things as well. If you go on there, it says, even so faith, if it hath not works, is dead, being alone. You can tell me all the time you're a Christian. You can tell me you have the strongest faith in the world. But if you're not acting upon that, the word says it's dead. And I got to thinking, what does dead mean? And you think about it in correlation to your faith. Is your faith alive or is your faith dead? Or do you even know? Dead means no longer living, without life, inactive, showing no force, motion, or lifeless. No longer operative, no longer used. Is that how you want to describe the faith that you have for God? No motion. Not operative, no longer used. He says right here in the Bible, if we're not putting works with our faith, they're dead. You can preach to me all day about how good a faith you've got, but if you're not acting on it, if you're not doing something, you're dead. If you've never begun for Christ, you're dead. Going down through here, it says, yea, a man may say, thou hast faith, and I have works. Show me thy faith without thy works, and I will show thee my faith by my works. Christian brothers and sisters are allowed to bear or to judge the fruit that other Christians bear. The Bible tells us that. And so when I look at someone and they say they're a Christian, I can tell whether they're a Christian by what they do, not by necessarily what they say. And sinners look at us the same way. They can tell if we are a Christian by what we do and what we say, but that we back up what we say. It goes on there, it says, thou believest that there is one God, thou doest well. The devils also believe and tremble. Now the devils believe, you say, I believe, so that's okay. The devils believe and the devils tremble. They fear. We need to fear also, but we need to be doing something. He says, but wilt thou know, O vain man, that faith without works is dead. If you're here today and you're not doing anything for God, you're here today and you're not supplying the need of brothers and sisters, your faith is dead. That's what the Bible says. And I hope it wakes us up to the point that we think, well, I need to get on the road and be doing some things. He repeats himself here and even states that the devils believe and that the devils tremble, but they're not presenting works for God, and we are to be presenting works to God. We're to be fruitful. It tells us in Psalms, even to an old age, there's not a period of time that we say, well, I fulfilled my need for God. I'm done. He doesn't need me any longer. Until we leave this earth, we are to be doing things. We're to be showing fruit for Jesus Christ. I want you to turn with me now to Matthew, and this again is some scripture, the 25th chapter of Matthew, that's been read many times here. But I want you to listen to these words, and I want us to see if we're doing these things that it tells us in the Word. Beginning with the 34th verse, the 25th book of Matthew. Then shall the king say unto them on the right hand, come, you blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. Are you here today in line, fulfilling the responsibilities to enter into that kingdom that God had prepared from the beginning? He said, for I was hungry and you gave me meat. It doesn't say I was hungry and you prayed that I'd get something to eat. It said, I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you took me in. Naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you came unto me. Do we do these things? Do we recognize the needs of others and act upon them? Or do we just look over them thinking, well, the next person coming by will take care of this. The next person coming by will get the reward if they do it, not us. Then shall the righteous answer him, saying, Lord, when shall we a hunger and fed thee, or thirsty and gave thee drink? When saw we thee a stranger and took thee in, or naked and clothed thee? Or when saw thee sick or in prison and came to you? Now listen to what he answers him here. And the king shall answer and say unto him, Verily I say unto you, inasmuch as you have done it unto the least of these my brethren, you've done it to me. You see, when we help our fellow companions here on earth, we're doing things for Christ. Brother Joe or Paul read to you about producing fruit. And God knows who's in the vine. He knows that. But what I'm trying to do today is get you woke up and realize, are you in the vine, or are you just lying to yourself all the time? I had mine Sue this week. She and I wrote up a list. It's in your bulletin. And these are some of the things that are done here at Lacey. I added a couple to it this morning, things that hit me, that prepare questions for the Bible Bowl, and I added onto it teach shape notes. I didn't count. You know how many there are, these Bible Sue? How many's on here? You can see. Are you doing any of these things that pertains to this congregation? Are you producing any works of this congregation, anything on this list which is not inclusive? There are probably things that we've left out. Or is this entertainment, like a movie? We just come here and we sit and take it all in and we go back home. And I sat and thought here today of the men that aren't here and the women and the things that people had to fill in and do. Because some of the people that do it regularly aren't here. Are we on a backup list? I think that was one of the lowest things. There's always a need for a backup at this job. And also one of the things, if you look down here, we have 44 officers in the offices in this church. We've got 22 people filling 44 offices in this congregation. I can't do that. I don't know how to do that. I didn't know how to preach, and I keep doing it, and I probably still don't have it right. But I'm going to keep preaching. And I got to trying to think, I probably got 10 of the things on this list. I'd be glad to give any of them up to anybody who wanted to do them. And anybody that's fulfilling these things would be. Got to top, and there's probably 10 people doing all these things. 10 out of, there's 60 here today. Are you producing the fruits that Paul was talking about? Is he going to purge you? Or are you dried and withered up and he's going to cut you down and burn you? This is my pep talk. Doc mentioned in his prayer that we're lucky here to have this church, that we have people that serve, and we are. But let's spread that out a little bit. Let's not burden people. Everybody's doing the same thing all the time. We need to be producing fruits. And if you are producing fruit, you're going to be happy. I'm happy to be standing right here today. You may think, man, that man's crazy today. I'm happy that God counts it worthy for me to get to do this. I think of those men that were beaten and stripes on them, and at the midnight they're singing praises to God. I'm happy that God is using me as a tool to help others. And if you get in line and get into some of these small things, I'll tell you one thing that I have. That you'll think, well, this is silly. Of course, I've got to say, I film. Ryan's filming today. I make sure the water stays in that water cooler, that when you come in, you can get water. Somebody else, I don't know who, keeps the cups up on the wall. Something that simple. I don't know how many things I've got on that list, but we could have people say, hey, could you use me somewhere that I could do some of these? I think I could do number 12 here. If there's who's doing that, I want to go see them. I want to fill in. I belonged to Civic Corps, Club a long time ago, and I told one of the members after I'd been gone a couple months, I said, I don't feel like I belong here because I'm not doing anything. They said, you just asked one time to do something, and he said, you'll belong. And I did. And the more I asked to do, the more they gave me. And the more I felt like I belonged. If you want to feel like you belong to Lacey Creek, get on this list. We have too many people with so much talent that 10 people don't need to be doing all this themselves. And we don't need to be wearing out 10 people. We have all kinds of offices to be held, and it's not usually an election, it's a selection, because when it comes to that, somebody says, I've done it last year, I'll do it again. I've done it last year, I've been doing it for 10 years, I'll do it again. We need people to step up and say, you know, I'd like to rest that person for a while. I'd like to feel that or try that and see if I can grow in the Lord a little bit. Do you want to grow in the Lord, or do you want to just sit back on your laurels and think, how could it be? You had the scripture read to you this morning. He said, I will purge them that work for me, and I will burn those that don't. And I think it's so appropriate that God gave that to Paul to read this morning, knowing this message that I was bringing. We had no contact with each other. I praise Paul for doing what the Lord put on his heart to do. And that's what makes the cohesiveness go here. In Galatians 6 and 10, it says, as we therefore have opportunity, to let us do good unto all men, especially unto them which are of the household of faith. When you're filling one of these tasks that's on this list, who do you think you're doing it to? You're doing it to those of the household of faith. In verse 9 of that same thing, it said, and let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap, if we faint not. If we don't die, if we're not dead, we're going to reap from that. John 6:29, Jesus said, this is the work of God, that you believe on him that sent me. We have to go with that thing to begin with. We have to believe that Jesus Christ was sent from God to come here and to save us from our sins. Belief is a work. Jesus said, if you continue in my word, then you are my disciples indeed. If you continue. Not, I got saved, I got baptized, kaboom, I'm ready. We have to endure to the end. Jesus said in Matthew 10 and 50, for whosoever shall do the will of my Father, which is in heaven, the same is my brother, my sister, and my mother. Are you doing the will of God? Or have you quit? Or have you never started? If you want to be a brother or a sister to Jesus Christ, you have to do the things he says, and he says you have to do the will of his Father. Revelations 3, 15 and 16. Listen to these verses. Listen to these verses in your heart and in your mind. It said, Jesus said, I know thy works. We're not fooling anybody. He said, I know what you're doing and what you're not doing. He said that thou art neither cold nor hot. I would that thou were cold or hot. Sometimes we get in that lukewarm stage and we think as long as we're lukewarm, we're okay because we're kind of warm. Then his response is, so then because thou art lukewarm and neither cold or hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth. It's kind of like the dried branches. He's going to get rid of it. He's going to burn it. Being idle does not get it done with God, and neither does never starting being with God. In our minds today, we need to commit to, what can I do for this congregation here at Lacey Creek? I attend here every Sunday. I come. And you know, that's a work, coming here, bringing your children. I know it's not easy to get up with children and get them ready to come here, to bring them for Sunday school. But I think you're going to receive a reward for that later in your life. This afternoon, there have been many volunteers put in a lot of hours to make sure an event's going to happen. It's back to school. You leave here and say, I don't care if my kids come to that. My kids are too young. My kids are too old. But yet there's been people taking of their time and volunteered and planned events and made things and cooked things and done things, and we walk away from it thinking, I don't care. How powerful could this congregation be if we all work together, if we all participated together and appreciated what each other does and showed the love for each other? We're going to stand and sing 114, which is, I want to be a worker for the Lord. If you're here today and God's put it on your heart to do something here in this congregation,
you know, as I got out of bed this morning, I planned on coming in here and reading those three pieces of scripture, turning it over to Brother Joe. Something kind of hit me, and I'd like to read it this morning. I want to ask today, how important is it that we know God's Word? How important is it for us that we study His Word? Several places throughout the scripture we're told to study. The one I'm going to go to today is 2 Timothy 2 and 15. He says, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Now, I mean, right there, I mean, we're going to have to prove ourselves to God and hope that he has mercy on us. Do we want to go before him and say, well, I don't know, Lord, I didn't study your word. I don't know why I didn't do that. Do we want to have answers? I'd like to turn to 1 Corinthians 10, verses 27 and 28. If any of them that believe not bid you to a feast, and ye be disposed to go, whatsoever is set before ye, eat, asking no questions for conscience' sake. But if any man say unto you, this is offered in sacrifice unto idols, eat not for his sake that showed it, and for conscience' sake. For the earth is the Lord's, and the fullness thereof. We're told in the scripture that we're not supposed to eat meat sacrificed unto other gods. And here we're told not to ask if we go to somebody's house. Sometimes ignorance can be bliss when in the ways of man. Things around us can be ignorance. You know, I run a gas station. I don't know how to be a police officer. I've got ignorance in that field. And when we go to someone's house or a restaurant, we shouldn't ask. Ignorance can be bliss. But when we find out, when we know, we're supposed to push it aside. And that's what's important about God's word. Through everything that we learn, through everything that we learn in his book, his word, when we see things that are unsettling because it's against God's word, we need to turn from it. At this time, we'll turn it over to Brother Joe.
Thank you, Brother Alex. I'd like to start today off again thanking the Lord for giving me this opportunity to stand before you. And if you want to, turn to 596 in your song book. God is calling the prodigal. I'm going to go along with a little bit of the message I've got today, if I get that far along with it, and I should. He's put a lot of things in my head last night, this morning. There's a few areas I wanted to go to that it wasn't what I had actually planned. Something more about 2 o'clock this morning, he put something in my head and just couldn't get it out of there. And I think I spoke on this a few months back, or a little bit of it anyway. Not in the same scripture area, but something similar to it. And I'm one of these persons, or people, I guess you'd say, that likes to take experiences I have with life and apply it to what God wants me to be or take out in front of it. I don't think things, and I used to when I was younger, I used to think things happen coincidentally. As I become older and more studied and realizing coincidence, not really a good word to use, I don't think, anymore. God plans things for us to do. Now, the thing about it is, we're not robots. God does not force us to do anything that we don't want to do. But he does expect something out of the Christian. And I try to tell people this, and I seem like it's more within the last few years, that people as a whole, I'm not saying everybody, I'm not saying, I ain't pointing fingers or nothing, I'll point them at me this morning, let's do it that way, I'll point them at me, is as we get in our life and we get stable, we get comfortable, we get to the places of complacent, I guess you'd say it, is we feel like we, or I, control. And that's the farthest from the truth that we can ever get. If it wasn't for the grace of God, I could not get up here this morning. I would not have come through those doors this morning. He gives me the air that I breathe. He gives me the place to lay my head down at night. He gives me the car I drive. He gives me. I do nothing on my own. I think I talked about this at one time, like I said a few months ago. It was sort of the same, but it keeps coming back to me, seems like. Is that the world is getting to a place, I demand this, this, or this. It's what I want to do. It's what I need. That's not what God tells us. That's not what Jesus practiced when he was here during the time of the four Gospels that his life was taught. That is not what he put the example of. He did never once go to them and say, I demand this, except one time. He run the money exchangers out of the temple. Because they was doing something that was so awful. He was making a den of thieves out of his place of worship. So he ran them out. Other than that, I don't know of any other time that our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ demanded anything except for us to follow in his footsteps. And I got to thinking about that a lot. It's been bothering me a whole lot in the last few months. Is I've got to have this today my way. I'm going to do something different. And it's so sad. It's so sad that we have to be that kind of people as a nation. It's my way or no way. As the old saying goes, if you ain't going to play the ball the way I'm going to play, I'm going to take my ball and I'm going to go home. What's wrong with us as a nation? What's wrong with us as a people? That we have to do things like this and hurt each other so bad. What's wrong with being a peacemaker? What's wrong with taking just a little bit, sitting back, Lord, give me the strength to get through this. What's wrong with saying, okay, Lord, it's going to cause a problem. Just keep my mouth shut. Do you see what I'm saying? Let me take you to a place, and I think I remember Jimmy talking about this a long time ago. I wasn't very old at the time, but I had nieces and nephews running around right here in this little church. And I'm going to take you to scriptures in just a few minutes to give you an example of what I'm trying to get at today. And they was playing and having a good time. And all of a sudden, wham, one of them hits another and it starts crying. And they get mad at each other. Guess what? Bet you it wasn't 5 minutes later they was hugging and kissing each other. Jesus, my Lord and Savior, should be your Lord and Savior. Humble himself for us. Oh, are we going to have problems? Well, sure. Are we going to get upset and want to raise our voice against somebody? Well, sure we are. But remember what Jesus did. Jesus humbled himself. He asked in the Garden of Gethsemane 3 times. He said, Father, let this cup pass from me. We can pray the same prayers. We don't have to see. I mean, I'm not saying don't pray for the Father to not help us. Pray that he will help you. Also pray with a humble spirit. Let's look in Matthew chapter 18 real quick. Since I made that point there just a second ago. Matthew 18. Turn with me. I don't want to take anything out of context. And I'm going to go ahead and tell you right up front. Is when I just take a few verses out, don't stop at those few verses. Write it down, do whatever you want to if you remember it, but go back and read the chapter before, the chapter after, finishing up the chapter. Don't take nothing out of context because it all fits together perfectly. The way I do it, it may not fit together. You may not understand it as well, but it all fits together perfectly. In chapter 18, starting with verse 1, it says, At the same time came the disciples unto Jesus, saying, Who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? A question. Well, we want to know who's the greatest, Lord. Who's the greatest up there? And Jesus called a little child unto him and set him in the midst of them, and said, Verily I say unto you, except ye be converted and become as little children, ye shall not enter into the kingdom of heaven. Whosoever therefore shall humble himself as this little child, the same is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. And whoso shall receive one such little child in my name, receiveth me. Do you understand what I was trying to tell you just a few minutes ago about a child? Have you ever watched kids get out and they be playing, having a good time, and all of a sudden something goes wrong? Next thing, they're at each other's throat. But within just a few short minutes, they're right back to their happy little selves again. That's the frame of mind I'm trying to get at this morning, is that we need to be as individuals, as a nation, which it's a sign of the times, I guess. As population keeps going on, guess what? We may multiply in Christianity. But guess what else is going on? We're going to also multiply in evilness and disobedience. As the population keeps going. I think that one of the brothers this morning spoke of it this morning. It doesn't matter, but anyway, it was spoken here and it's been spoken several times. The gates of hell is wide. The gates to heaven is narrow. That gives you some kind of an indication of what we're up against. Why is the nation being like it is? That gives you an idea. There's not that many humble people anymore. We all demand something. Me, myself, and I want things. And at times I demand things. Am I right in what I'm doing? I need to go back and check this as Brother Alex read a few minutes ago. We need to find out what God's word is and see if we're all right to demand what we need to demand when we need to demand it. There are certain things we are required to do as individuals, as a Christian. We need to do it according to God's word, not according to my feelings. There's a lot of times my feeling gets in the way of my better judgment. Or at least in the judgment of what Christ wants me to do or wants me to be. What do I need to do? I need to step myself back down. I've noticed in myself, don't know about everybody else, but I have noticed within myself that when everything is going good, when finances are being taken care of, my bills are being met, when my job is going the way I want it to go, then I'm on top of the world and feeling great. But when my props gets knocked out from under me, and I get pretty low, and I get pretty complaining, and I get pretty hateful, even when I was on top of the world, guess who was putting me there? It wasn't me. It was God letting me have a high for a little while. And when I get to where I couldn't understand that that high was coming from God, the props will get knocked out from under me. I have to depend upon Him again. But I have yet to ever get in a place. Now, I may get there. The Lord may let me go there one of these days. So far, He's not. I have been very blessed with the things I've done. Have I had everything I wanted? Well, no. And I'm going to tell you why I haven't. It's because the Lord knows if He gives me certain things, I will destroy myself. The same way that our nation throughout the world is doing today, when we get too high and mighty of our own personal selves, we will absolutely destroy ourselves. There is no other way we'll do it, because Satan will get a hold of us. That's what Satan wants. Satan wants you to be mighty and in control of your destiny. Or so you think, or I think, we are in control.